This video is sponsored by Card Kingdom. You can pre-order Ravnica Allegiance at cardkingdom.com right now. Hello everyone, I'm Nietzsche Hone, and earlier today the entire Ravnica Allegiance spoiler was posted, and that means it's time for Limited Review Week here on my channel. When a new set is fully spoiled, I post a new video every day for over a week, covering my thoughts about all the cards in the format, as well as my picks for the best commons and uncommons, the biggest bombs, and an archetype guide. This is the first video of the week, and in it I will share my thoughts on every white card in Guilds of Ravnica. One caveat to keep in mind, my assessment of these cards is based on an initial impression, obviously enough, I haven't played the format yet. Additionally, if you aren't familiar with how I grade cards, there is a link in the description that will take you to a video where I explain what my letter grades mean. Now, let's look at the first white card. So, we're starting with an impressive one. We're starting with Angel of Grace, which for 3 generic and 2 white is a mythic rare angel. It's a 5/4 with flash and flying. When it enters the battlefield, until end of turn, damage that would reduce your life total to less than 1 reduces it to 1 instead. And then, you can pay 4 generic and 2 white to exile her from your graveyard, and your life total becomes 10. So, a 5-mana 5/4 flyer with flash would probably be a firm B, maybe a B+. Once flash creatures get this big, flashing them in and killing something becomes easier. Add the rest of the text on this thing and it clearly becomes a straight-up bomb, something it was already pretty close to being with keywords and stats alone. The fact that she can make it so you don't die for a turn will come up from time to time, and it's a pretty cool reference to the old card Angel's Grace, too. There will be times where you flash this to save you and maybe trade and then put your life back up to 10 on your turn. That's not the ideal scenario for her, certainly you'd rather she stay in play, but she can do some good work in a variety of situations and help you come back from the brink of losing. All of that makes her a straight up bomb, and I'm giving her an A. You first pick her in the vast majority of packs. The only way you wouldn't is if there's basically another mythic rare in a pack that is better than this one, which there aren't very many of. Next, we have Angelic Exaltation, which for 3 generic and a white is an uncommon enchantment, and it says whenever a creature you control attacks, it gets plus X until end of turn, where X is the number of creatures you control. This sort of enchantment really has an effect that alters the way the game is played by you. Being able to hold back all your blockers but smash in with one big thing can really be a problem for your opponent. I often don't like 4-mana enchantments that don't impact the board right away, and that's what this will be sometimes. But on a lot of boards, it will enable an attack right away, meaning it isn't always going to do nothing on the board. I think it is really here for use with the Afterlife mechanic, which we haven't seen yet but we'll get to, which not only gives you an evasive creature in the spirit token, but also enables you to keep the board populated more easily than other decks. However, I do think this is a bit of a win more card. If you have enough creatures in play that your creature can smash in really hard, attacking with all of them most of the time is also going to have a big impact. I think this is probably just a C, the kind of card that you play in your decks that can go pretty wide because it can really make it so you can more safely attack your opponent. Like, if you're really behind and you have to leave a lot of blockers back and just attack with one thing at a time, this can be nice, but there's going to be a lot of scenarios where it doesn't make that much of a difference, and it's still a 4-mana enchantment that oftentimes won't impact the board immediately. And all of that means it's not a great card. If it goes in any direction, I think it will probably actually slip down to the D level. I think that's more likely than it moving up to even C+. Next, we have Archway Angel, which for 4 generic and a white is a 3/4 angel at uncommon. It has flying, and when it enters the battlefield, you gain 2 life for each gate you control. So a 6-mana 3/4 with flying is not the greatest rate, but it's not the worst thing either. It's probably about a D. You would play it if things go bad in your draft. You would probably hope you don't play it, but it's not completely unplayable. Add to that the gate payoffs that you have here. There are several of those in this set, just like in the last one, and I would say overall, you know, as we go through the set here, the gate payoffs in this set seem stronger to me, but that's not really true of this card. I think for you to feel like paying 6 mana is a good deal for this, you probably have to gain at least 4 life, which probably means you need to have around 5 gates in your deck, and that's not something that's going to happen super easily. You're going to have to force it a little bit. As I just mentioned, there are reasons to do it. Even if the angel isn't a reason to do it, it's sort of an extra benefit that you get out of the fact that you're probably already paying a bunch of gates for other reasons. Obviously, she can gain you more than 4 life, too, and that's great, but I think there's going to be a significant number of decks where more likely she's going to gain you 0 or 2 life, and in those cases, she's not going to feel great, but, you know, she is playable. I think she's a build-around, basically. I give her a D in a deck without enough gates, and a C in a deck that does have enough gates to really make it so they gain 4 or more life with her the majority of the time. Next, we have Arrester's Zeal, which for one white mana is a common instant. It says target creature gets +2/+2 until end of turn, and it has Addendum, which is the Azorius mechanic in this set, where if you cast something during your main phase that you could normally cast during other times, you get an extra bonus. In this case, if you cast it during a main phase, that creature gains flying until end of turn. One mana +2/+2 combat tricks are always decent in aggressive decks, and I like the added flexibility this has because of Addendum. Most of the time, the way to get the most value out of this will be to just use it traditionally as a combat trick at instant speed. That's when you can kill an opponent's blocker and keep your guy alive. You can use it to help it survive damage-based spells. But if your opponent is close to dead, doesn't have any flyers, and doesn't have the mana or cards to do anything in response, the Addendum version of this card will be a potential way to just end the game with a big hit in the air. As a trick, it has the problems they all have. You can get 2-for-1 if you aren't careful, and it's very difficult for tricks to be much more than sort of an average filler kind of card. But Solid is actually pretty good, at least as far as tricks go, and I think you play one copy of this most of the time in your white decks, and I'm giving it a C. Next up, we have Bring to Trial, which for 2 generic and a white is a common sorcery, and it says exile target creature with power 4 or greater. You get a white card like this in basically every set. They're always serviceable, but never anything special. I think you can play this main board, but it probably just gets out of the range, just barely out of the range of, I really wish I wasn't playing this in my main board, which means it's like a C-. It just can't target everything, and sometimes what you need, frequently what you need to do, is kill a smaller creature. There will be some opponents it's near useless against. Being sorcery speed doesn't help its case either. I think it is probably best to have it in your sideboard. I think out of your sideboard where you can bring it in and against opponents who have a number of larger creatures, it's probably a C+. So, you know, overall, this is an okay card. It's one that, ideally, you're probably not playing in your main deck, but it will be nice out of your sideboard against certain opponents. Next up, we have Civic Stalwart, which for 3 generic and a white is a 3/3 elephant soldier at common, and when it enters the battlefield, creatures you control get +1/+1 until end of turn. We see a creature like this in a lot of sets, and they're always pretty nice. In this format, with Afterlife and the Spirit Tokens, it may be even better, since making your 3 Spirit Tokens into 2/2s for a turn is pretty nice. In general, playing this guy in turn 4 is going to make attacks possible that just wouldn't be otherwise. Even in the absolute worst fail case where you have no board at all, you could do worse than a 4-mana 3/3, especially because most of the time it's going to have that upside. I think this guy is the kind of white card that you probably never cut the first copy of, but you don't want to go after it super early either. I don't think it's like a first pickable common or anything like that. I think it's just a C+. Next, we have Concordia Pegasus, which for 1 generic and a white is a 1/3 Pegasus at common, and it has flying. 2-mana 1/3 flyers are another thing we see a lot of, and they're always decent, but not much more than that. There's a small chance this ends up moving up a little, because it can block those pesky spirit tokens, but I think as it stands, this is often your 23rd or 24th card that will make the cut more often than not, but just barely, and I'm giving it a C-. Next, we have Exposed to Daylight, which for 2 generic and a white is a common instant, and it says destroy target artifact or enchantment, scry 1. So, I don't think there are enough artifacts and enchantments in this set for this to be something you want to put in your main deck. It's a good sideboard card, though. I love scrying, and adding that to disenchant for 1 more mana is worth it to me. Scrying is great because it improves the quality of your draws. I think that this is the kind of card you play in your main deck in worst-case scenarios, which means it's like a D-, but as a sideboard card, it's like a C+. I think ideally you have one of these, you pick up one of these late and have it in your sideboard anytime you draft white. Next up, we have Forbidding Spirit, which for 1 generic and 2 white is a 3/3 Spirit Cleric at uncommon, and when it enters the battlefield until your next turn, creatures can't attack you or a planeswalker you control unless their controller pays 2 for each of those creatures. So 3-mana 3/3s are usually C's on their own in limited, and this one brings with it a very relevant ability in making your opponent get Ghostly Prison for a turn. This means that this is a creature with efficient stats that has utility basically at any point in the game. That said, it won't always make a difference late. It will definitely delay those alpha strikes and make your opponent make difficult decisions about building their board or attacking. It will do those things pretty often, but I think sometimes you'll play it late and it doesn't make a real difference. That said, you still played a 3-mana 3/3. Overall, I like this. 3-drop creatures with efficient stats and late-game impact aren't exactly abundant in most limited formats. I think in some weaker packs, this might be worth considering taking with your first pick, which means it's a B-. Next, we have Hazda Officer, which for 2 generic and a white is a 3/2 human soldier at common, and when it enters the battlefield, target creature you control gets +1/+1 until end of turn. This is like the classic definition of a C. He offers decent stats for his mana cost. You know, a 3-mana 3-2 would be like a D, maybe a D-plus on its own. And he has an ability that is relevant, but not the most powerful thing around. He can enable you to attack with something maybe that couldn't have attacked otherwise. But he's filler, and you'll probably always play the first copy of him, which makes him a C. Next, we have Hero of Precinct 1, which for one generic and a white is a 2-2 human warrior at rare, and it says whenever you cast a multicolored spell, create a 1-1 white human creature token. So this is a bit of a build-around, but not the kind that is unplayable if you don't get enough synergy, which in this case means having a lot of multicolored cards. Since it's a Grizzly Bears in a worst-case scenario, and in a deck that isn't even trying to get synergy, you will probably have at least a few gold cards. I mean, it is a Ravnica set, so I think it has a floor of about C. But if you end up in a deck that has a ton of gold cards, it basically becomes Young Pyromancer, and that is an incredibly powerful card. I think in some weaker packs, first picking this because it has a high ceiling is not a bad idea. I mean, I think it's a B if you get there on synergy. And I think taking it relatively early and seeing if you can make it work is probably a good idea too, just because the floor is not something that's going to really destroy you. First picking it isn't the worst plan ever. Next, we have Impassioned Orator, which for one generic and a white is a 2-2 human cleric at common. And whenever another creature enters the battlefield under your control, you gain one life. 2-mana 2-2s that are just vanilla are probably around D-plus these days, as crazy as that sounds. There used to be a time where they were like a C. This does have a relevant ability, one that will work best with probably Afterlife, but it isn't anything special. These types of slow life gain effects don't tend to be good in formats where there isn't a life gain archetype, and this isn't one of those formats. He is solid, certainly, and you can do worse on a 2-drop, but I think his ability is only enough to push him up to C-. I see myself cutting this a significant portion of the time. When you do play it, it's because you're like, man, I need more 2-drops, not because you're like, oh boy, Impassioned Orator. Next up, we have Justicar's Portal, which for one generic and a white is a common instant, and it says exile target creature you control, then return that card to the battlefield under its owner's control. It gains first strike until end of turn. Well, this is interesting. Exiling effects like this are usually at their best with creatures who have enter the battlefield abilities, but this one gives you a bonus when the creature comes back into play, giving it first strike. So it's sort of like a bad combat trick and a mediocre way to abuse into the battlefield abilities. You can use a card like this in response to removal too. It's always worth keeping in mind. That said, effects like this are almost always underwhelming, whether you add first strike or not. There are some creatures who have enter the battlefield abilities that you really want to abuse, but I don't see this as being anything other than a card you're unhappy to have to play, and I think that means it's a D. Next up, we have Knight of Sorrows, which for 4 generic and a white is a 3-3 human knight at common. It can block an additional creature each combat, and it has Afterlife, a mechanic I've mentioned a lot, and here's the first version of it. So creatures with Afterlife have Afterlife and then a numeral. Whatever that numeral is means when they die, you get that many 1-1 white and black spirit creature tokens with flying. And that is, of course, the Orzhov mechanic. So what would a 5-mana 3-3 that can block additional things be on its own? I think it would probably be an F, or really, really close to it. It's not going to be a good attacker. Sure, it can sort of buy you a little bit of time, but paying 5-mana for a little and a card for a little bit of time isn't good. Does the Afterlife make a big difference? I mean, I think it does make a big difference, taking it out of the range of utterly unplayable and instead pushing it up to the do I really have to play this level, which is still not good, but it is better. Afterlife is a powerful mechanic, as we'll see, but this is so inefficient, I don't think it's worth it most of the time, and I think it's just a D. Next up, we have Lumbering Battlement, which for 4 generic and a white is a 4-5 beast at rare. It has Vigilance, and when it enters the battlefield, you exile any number of other non-token creatures you control until it leaves the battlefield, and it gets +2/+2 for each card exiled with it. I like this a fair bit. 5-mana 4-5 with Vigilance does pretty well on the vanilla test, and obviously this has way more upside than that. You can use it to exile creatures who have become irrelevant on certain boards, which you know happens as games grind on, or creatures shut down by aura removal spells, or creatures with nice enter the battlefield abilities, so that if your opponent does manage to kill this huge creature, they're going to be dealing with stuff coming back. And killing it won't be easy. I mean, even at 6-7, where you only exile one thing, this will not go down easily. I know I don't comment on flavor a ton, but the flavor here is also pretty awesome. Overall, I don't think this is quite like a bomb. Probably needed evasion to get there, but I imagine playing against this being pretty awful. It's going to be a pick-your-poison scenario, even if you do get the removal spell to kill it. Note, though, that if your opponent slaps an aura-based removal spell on this, that's not going to be very fun for you. Overall, though, I think he just misses out on, you know, being an A-level card, a straight-up bomb, but he's pretty close. He's as close as you can get, really, and he is a B+. Next up, we have Ministrant of Obligation, which for 2 generic and a white is a 2-1 human cleric at uncommon with Afterlife 2. So, a 3-mana 2-1 isn't great on the vanilla test, but in the end, for this card, you get 4-3 worth of stats for only 3 mana, and 2 of that is flying. 2-2 of that is flying. The ideal scenario, with basically all of these cards with Afterlife, is to trade them for something and then get the spirits. So you're always coming out ahead on the trades. And that's not exactly a pie-in-the-sky scenario. Your opponent plays a 2-drop, you play Ministrant of Obligation, they attack with the 2-drop, and you block. And now they already have a headache because of the issues you're causing them. This is so efficient and gives you such a good deal on the stats you get and on the bodies you get. I think it is worth first picking in a lot of packs, and it's a straight-up B, I think. I think it is one of White's best uncommons. Next, we have Prowling Caracal, which for 1 generic and a white is a 3-1 cat at uncommon. Look, White always gets this obligatory 2-mana 3-1 creature. They're always fine as 2-drops, and they're usually like a C-. Sometimes we have formats where they can get as high as C. This is especially true in faster, more aggressive formats, but I'm going to give it the lower grade now of C-. Next up, we have Rally to Battle, which for 3 generic and a white is an uncommon instant, and it says creatures you control get +1/+3 until end of turn, untap them. This seems like a reasonable way to pump your whole team and make sure a good chunk of your creatures survive combat. While it does let you untap your guys, which may make you want to do a gotcha thing when your opponent attacks you, I think most of the time you want to use this while you're the one attacking so you can take full advantage of the damage that gets through to your opponent. This seems a bit like Inspired Charge type cards we've seen in the past, where if you cast it at the right moment, you can take a huge chunk of your opponent's life and a huge chunk of their board down with you. This one isn't quite as good as Inspired Charge at doing lethal out of nowhere because it only boosts power by 1, but I think it will be okay. All that said, it isn't like Inspired Charge is an incredible card in Limited, it's just a card that fits into some decks. Obviously, this goes quite well with aggro decks and Afterlife, so I think Orzhov makes the most sense for it. The problem this has, that all mass pump spells have, is that you have to have a formidable board in most cases for it to really do the job, and because you can't always count on that being the case, you have to take into account how bad it is sometimes, and it's going to be super bad sometimes, basically unusable. I think you play a copy of this some of the time in your white decks and feel alright about it, but I think a lot of the time you probably just don't want to play this. I'm giving it a C-. Next, we have Resolute Watchdog, which for 1 white mana is a 1-3 hound at uncommon. He has Defender, and he has an activated ability where you can pay 1 generic and sacrifice him to give a creature you control indestructible until end of turn. I don't think this is very good. It doesn't do much. I mean, yeah, I know it can block grizzly bears. That's great. So can lots of 2-drops that can actually attack or trade with the creature. It has an ability that could come up sometimes to be sure, and it will sometimes be a pain to play against, but that doesn't equate to it being a card you're happy about having in your deck. I know Orzhov has a bit of a sacrifice theme going, but mostly you want to be sacrificing your creatures with Afterlife, not this. I don't think it's unplayable, don't get me wrong, but I think it's the kind of card that is pretty easy to cut from your deck, which makes it a D+. Next, we have Sentinel's Mark, which for 1 generic and a white is an uncommon enchantment aura with enchant creature. It has flash, it says enchanted creature gets +1/+2 and has vigilance, and it has addendum. If you cast this during your main phase, the creature gains lifelink until end of turn. I like the design here. I think the addendum designs, a lot of them are pretty cool. Sure, giving your guy vigilance at instant speed doesn't matter at all, but giving the option to use this as a combat trick, which will be frequently advantageous, is pretty great. On top of that, casting it during your main phase isn't too bad either, as sometimes you need that lifelink to really wildly swing a race in your favor. Like all addendum cards, it is basically a split card with those two options. It's still an aura, with all the inherent risks that always come with auras, namely the dreaded 2-for-1, but I think it is a reasonably playable one because of its flexibility to sort of either be a combat trick or a more offensive aura, and I'm giving it a C. Next, we have Sky Tether, which for 1 white mana is an aura at uncommon. It has enchant creature, and it says enchanted creature has defender and loses flying. This kind of aura will be useful for shutting down really scary creatures, sort of. The annoying thing with cards like this that we've seen before is that most creatures that are really scary that you need to stop them from attacking you anyway, they're also good blockers. And obviously this doesn't stop that, and that's always kind of a problem. I guess the ideal place to use it is if your deck is loaded with flyers, so you can use it to get the few creatures that can block your flyers out of the way, while also making it so they can't attack. And don't get me wrong, I don't think this is terrible. I do think it's the kind of removal spell you run when you're really desperate, though, and don't have other good removal spells. And I think a lot of the time you do cut this if you get the better removal spells that are around. Removal is one of the hardest things to get in limited, and I think overall this ends up being okay at that job, but I think it's probably a C- because you certainly aren't like, oh boy, Sky Tether, I really got a great removal spell. It's going to deal with my opponent's creatures exactly how I want to. And that's why I think it's a C-. Next, we have Smothering Tithe, which for 3 generic and a white is a rare enchantment, and it says whenever an opponent draws a card, that player may pay 2. If the player doesn't, you create a colorless treasure artifact token with tap, sacrifice this artifact, add 1 mana of any color. This is a cool way to give white fixing that doesn't seem like it breaks the color pie. I think it's pretty cool in terms of the taxing thing going on. That said, I don't think it's very good in limited. Sure, you get treasure tokens and that could matter. Fixing is great, and white often isn't good at getting fixing, but this format has guild gates, and they're just going to be better most of the time. This costs 4 mana and has no immediate impact on the board. There will be plenty of times where the treasure tokens don't accomplish anything. This seems like a card designed with EDH in mind more than any other format, and I don't think you want to play this in limited at all. I think it's just an F. Next up, we have Spirit of the Spires, which for 3 generic and a white is a 2/4 spirit at uncommon. It's got flying, and other creatures you control with flying get +0/+1. A 4 mana 2/4 with flying is already a pretty good deal stats-wise. It's probably at least a C. Adding the ability to pump the toughness of other flying creatures could certainly come in handy. Making all those spirit tokens into 1/2s, for example, certainly doesn't hurt. There is a blue creature we will get to in tomorrow's video that pumps the power of creatures with flying, and while I like pumping power more than toughness, this creature does a better job on the vanilla test, so I think the two cards are really comparable, and obviously they want to be played together. I think you play it in any white deck where it can be a nice blocker or attacker in the sky. It doesn't even really matter if you get the +0/+1 going. Obviously you want to, but it's got a really reasonable floor. Like I said, it's probably at least a C, and then being able to pump your flyers is nice too, and I think all of that makes it a C+. Next up, we have Summary Judgment, which for 1 generic and a white is a common instant, and it deals 3 damage to target tapped creature, and it has addendum. In this case, if you cast it during your main phase, it deals 5 damage to that creature instead. This is a good common removal spell for white, to be sure. It's another one of those sort of split addendum cards. You can use it to kill something that's actually attacking you before it hits you, and if it's small enough, or if something's really big and you really desperately want to kill it, instead, you can take the hit from it or chump block it or whatever, and then kill it during your main phase with the addendum. That said, I don't think this falls into the category of premium removal. The reason being that it's entirely situational. You need creatures to be tapped. It isn't premium removal because, like, an aggressive deck doesn't really want to be running this most of the time. This is because you want removal that gets blockers out of the way, and Summary Judgment just doesn't do it. It can only kill other creatures that are attacking you. I mean, I'm not trying to say this is a bad card or anything. I'm just trying to say I think it does fall short, just short of being something that you think about first picking. Instead, I think it's a nice removal spell that you play a couple copies of and feel fine about, but it's not a removal spell that's really going to be game-altering a lot of the time, especially if you're the more aggressive deck. If you're an Azorius deck, which looks like it's going to be a more controlling deck, maybe this gets a little bit better because you don't care whether the creatures you're killing are tapped or not. You just need to be killing creatures and making the game go long. Overall, though, I think this all means that this is a C+. Next up, we have Syndicate Messenger, which for 3 generic and a white is a 2/3 bird with flying and Afterlife 1 at common. So a 4 mana 2/3 flyer is probably like a D or a D+. When we add Afterlife to that, how big of an improvement is it? Well, in the end, I think paying 4 mana for 3/4 worth of flying stats is an okay deal. We can't really judge this, of course, as a 4 mana 3/4 with flying. That would be even better. It isn't quite that good, but I do think this is a solid filler card in your white decks. I'm giving it a C. Next up, we have 10th District Veteran, which for 2 generic and a white is a 2/3 human soldier at common. She's got vigilance, and when she attacks, you untap another target creature you control. We see this kind of effect pretty often, and it's usually underwhelming. It sort of lets you give a creature vigilance for a turn or whatever, but that is an effect that is usually only marginally relevant. The veteran comes with decent stats on her own as a 3 mana 2/3 with vigilance, which would probably be good enough for like a C- anyway, and I don't think her ability gets her much higher than that, so I think that's what I'm going to give her, the C-. Next up, we have Tithe Taker, which for 1 generic and a white is a 2/1 human soldier at rare, and it says during your turn, spells your opponents cast cost 1 more to cast, and abilities your opponents activate cost 1 more to activate unless they're mana abilities, and it has Afterlife 1. So a 2-mana 2/1 that has Afterlife 1 is probably already like a B-. I mean, you're getting a relatively efficient body, and it can replace itself. It can do the trading thing really nice and then give you a flyer early. Add to that all the other stuff that this card has going on, and I do think it gets a little bit better, but I don't think it gets a lot better. There are activated abilities around, and, you know, making your opponent's Guild Mage abilities cost more if they're used during your turn is great. Making their instants cost more if they're used during your turn is also great. The thing that's not so great is that this format also has Addendum, which is already sort of incentivizing people to cast spells on their own turn anyway. Obviously, that's really only in blue and white, but that is something relevant that you have to take into account. I don't think that most of the time the text on here is going to make an impact in the game. You know, if you draft it and you cast it, you know, half your games, maybe it'll make one play slightly different for your opponent, but I think sometimes it won't matter at all. I think most of the time this is just a 2-mana 2/1 with Afterlife 1, but guess what? That's already a really good card. I think that's a B- on its own. This could go higher. I could be wrong. There may be enough activated abilities people want to use during your turn that this moves up, and that huge block of text actually matters more than the Afterlife 1, and that would be cool if that's the case. But as is, I already think it's a first pickable card and a nice card to have in your deck, one you're actively happy about having, as you know, the B grade indicates. Next up, we have Twilight Panther, which for 1 white mana is a 1/2 cat spirit at common, and you can pay 1 black mana to give it death touch until end of turn. I always like creatures you can trade for anything, and in the Orzhov deck, where it will be easiest to play this, I think this fits especially well. You'll want to lock down the ground and attack in the air with spirit tokens in most cases, and this can serve as a major roadblock for your opponent. These kinds of death touch creatures are kind of weird because they are low curve creatures who are most impactful in the late game. If you play it early and you trade it for like a 2/2, that doesn't exactly feel great. It's not bad, but it's not where you're going to get the most value. So early on, these cheap creatures are actually not that good, and that's sort of something that keeps them from being absolutely incredible, because yeah, they can trade for everything, but sometimes there's not really anything to trade with, especially early. But I think you play this in every Orzhov deck, you play at least one copy and you feel fine about it, maybe even play two, and I think that just makes it a solid C. Next, we have Unbreakable Formation, which for 2 generic and a white is a rare instant, and it says creatures you control gain indestructible until end of turn, and then it has Addendum: if you cast a spell during your main phase, put a +1/+1 counter on each of those creatures, and they gain vigilance until end of turn. Well, this is strong. It's yet another Addendum card that you should probably cast with Addendum most of the time. Generally, a card like this that just gives your whole team indestructible is not that good. 3 mana to do that usually isn't that good. It frequently acts more as a fog effect, and we all know those aren't very good. But the Addendum here really pushes this into really powerful territory. It permanently pumps your creatures with those counters and gives them vigilance on top of indestructible, and now you're really in business. This is because it gives you a completely free attack against your opponent. You aren't losing blockers because they have vigilance, and you aren't losing any creatures because they have indestructible. Those kinds of free attacks, where you can just rumble with everything and not even worry about it, are a real headache for your opponent, especially if your board is imposing. Even if your board isn't imposing, they have to probably do some ugly trades and things like that, or take a huge amount of damage. Sure, you do have to have something of a board going on for this to be at its best, but even if you only have like 2 creatures in play and you cast Unbreakable Formation, it's going to be pretty powerful. The turn you play this is going to be a beating for your opponent, and making your creatures permanently bigger is going to have a long-term impact on the game as well. Obviously, your deck does have to be creature-heavy to use this, but I don't think that will be a problem most of the time. Overall, I think this is just a B. I think it's so powerful and can make you just win the game on the spot, that it's worth first picking, and that's what the B sort of indicates. Next, we have Watchful Giant, which for 5 generic and a white is a 3/6 giant soldier at common, and when he enters the battlefield, you get a 1/1 white human creature token. 6 mana for 4/7 worth of stats certainly isn't irrelevant. The 2 bodies can probably help you stabilize if you're in trouble. But usually, if I'm paying 6 mana and I want to play a 6 drop, I want to play something that's threatening, not a card that's almost purely defensive like this is. I think most of the time he just doesn't make the cut. I'm giving him a D+. Well, those are all the white cards, mono white cards anyway, in Ravnica Allegiance. Tomorrow, come back to see my thoughts on all the blue cards in the format. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like it and share it so others can enjoy it too. If you want to make sure you catch the rest of my set review videos and a lot of Ravnica Allegiance limited content to come, including draft videos, don't forget to subscribe. Thanks for watching.